Okay, so we're going to look at shear and moment diagrams. All right, so this is an example I've used a couple of times. We've got a beam sticking out of a wall with a fixed support, and we previously figured out that we've got a reaction moment and a reaction force holding this beam up. And so what we have done in the past has been like, oh, I'm just going to pick a point here and then examine its internal forces on this side and this side, and yay! And that's basically what we're going to do now, except we're going to try and do it in general. So just to give you an idea how this is going to play out, I'm going to solve the same problem like three different times. Well, kind of, at least twice, but it's really important to kind of look at it because what we're going to do is kind of like show the math way of doing it, and it's going to feel like, oh, my brain. But then what's going to happen is then I'll be able to show you, okay, but now as long as you understand all this stuff, let me show you kind of a workaround. But you still need to know the basics, because what will happen is you'll get into mechanics materials and then you need to know exact points and functions, and you're going to end up doing second order ODEs and stuff like that. So you still need to know how to do all this, but this is just a start, okay? So basically what we're going to do is we're going to start by creating just this like little section here, like somewhere before the 5 pounds. So the 5 pounds is out here somewhere. Okay, so we still have our little 8 pound doodad, and we have our 40 inch pound thingy. Okay, and we're some unknown distance x away from wherever we happen to be. So that means that we're going to have some kind of a shear here, which is going to be a function of x, right? So I'm going to erase this 5 pounds. I just mean the 5 pounds, we have not got to the 5 pounds yet. There's going to be a normal, which we actually aren't going to really care about because these are shear diagrams. And then there's going to be this moment. Okay, so m as a function of x. So these are all functions of x. Now n is, can I just say clearly, zero, because there's no other forces in the x direction. Okay, so basically what we're going to do is kind of like around this little point right here. Let's take the sum of the forces, not the sum of the forces, well, we can do that too. The sum of the forces in the y direction, we can say, okay, so I have 8 going up and I have v as a function of x going down. And so that needs to equal 0. So v at x is equal to 8. So as long as, let's say, for x that's in the set going from 0 to wherever that 5 showed up, the 5 showed up at the 2. So anywhere between 0 and 2, what we're doing is going to be valid. Okay, so now let's take the sum of the moments about that little one thingy. Okay, so it'll be the 8 pounds this way. That's going to be a negative moment. So 8 times x, negative moment. We have the 40 inch pounds that's handed in there, and then that reaction moment for bending that we don't know what it is. So m at x is equal to 8x minus 40. All right, so we're just going to put that somewhere. It's linear. So we can also say, like, at x equals 2, then that's going to be 8 times 2 minus 40, which is going to be 16 minus 40, that's negative 24. So it's linear, and that value there is negative 24. Okay, so that's kind of the first step. Okay, so let's draw that in a little bit. We're going to draw in the first section. So I like to draw my shear and moment diagrams so they line up, like one right after the other, and I'll show you why later, but it's a really good idea. So this is my shear, and this will be my moment. I happen to know that all my shears are going to be positive, so I'm going to draw that line there, and I happen to know that all my moments are going to be negative, so I'm going to draw that up there. So v of x and m of x. Okay, so I know that my shear here is going to be 8. So I've got this value of 8, and it's going to extend all the way to, like, see, this is the 2, this is the 2, and this is the 2, and I'll make this the 10 and the 10. So 2, 2, 10, 10. Okay. So it's going to go right to here. And now that you've got this, like, question, like you do in college algebra, is like, is this an open circle or a closed circle? Because it's not really continuous. It's a little weird. So I'm going to just draw it where it goes straight. Now, technically, there should be an open circle, and I get it. Okay, there's supposed to be an open circle, but we get lazy because we're engineers and not mathematicians. So technically it's going to look like it's not really a function because it's going to have two values, but I'll leave it as an open circle for a second so we can kind of sort of try to remember. Okay, now here our moment is going to be at 2, oh, I forgot to figure out what it is at 0. So the moment reaction at 0 is going to be A times 0 is 0 minus 40 is negative 40. So at 0, it's negative 40, which is way down here, negative 40, way down here. And then at 2, it is negative 24, like that. Okay, so I got this here, and it's linear. Now, it doesn't really look like it has a slope of 8, but that's because this scale is a lot different than this scale. But that has a slope of 8. Okay, funsies. Now I'm going to go and do this again, but for the next section. Okay, so I've got myself my little doodad here, and it's going to go now past the 5, but before the 3. Okay, so there's the 5, and I've still got the reaction. And I've still got the reaction, like that. Okay, and now I am measuring all the way from here. Okay, now I still have the little pieces. I've got the shear that's gonna be a function. Well, here we go. I'm gonna have the shear that's a function of x. The normal is gonna be 0, I'm not even gonna bother drawing it. And then I have the reaction moment, which is a function of x as well. Okay, and I'm gonna call this little point here too. So I've got the sum of the forces in the y direction. I've got 8 pounds going up, 5 pounds going down, and some unknown shear going down. So that means that my unknown shear is equal to 3. So that's good. It's also a constant. Now let's do the sum of the moments around that 1, or 2, around this 2. Okay, so I've got this 8, x is a negative moment here. So I've got negative 8 times x is that. And then I have this here is going to be a positive moment. And what is its distance going to be? Let's see, what was this? This was 2. So it's going to be x minus 2 times 5, which is positive. So plus 5 times x minus 2. And then, of course, the unknown moment, which is drawn in, is positive, and that's equal to 0. Okay, so now I can do math because I'm super good at this kind of math. Mx is equal to 8x minus 5x plus 10, I think. Wait, what's 5 times 2? Oh, I forgot the 40. Oh, my goodness. Holy mackerel. That was scary. 40. Don't forget 40. She matters. She's important. There's the 40. I was like, why is this not looking right? Okay, now let's try this. I said I was good at math. I didn't say I was good at, you know, fundamentally not sucking as a person. Okay, minus 5x plus 10 minus 40. So much for saying I was good at algebra. This is what I get for talking trash. All right, so I have m at x is equal to 3x minus 30. So that means that, and this is good for x going from 2 to 10. Okay, so m at 2 would be 6 minus 30 is 24, so that's continuous, that's nice. And then m at 10 is going to be 30 minus 30 is 0. Perfect, perfect, perfect. Okay, now I'm going to draw these in. Okay, so I've got the shear is at 3, so this is not continuous. It literally hops right over here. And again, I'm putting those initially as hollow because you're always going to be like, but what happens at exactly that point? And it's like, if we were mathematicians, we would care, but we're just trying to solve real-world problems, in which case, whatever happens at infinity, we don't, or as we get infinitely close, we don't really care. So I'm actually going to get rid of those, and I'm just going to join this. So I know it's not a function anymore because it doesn't pass the vertical line test, but whatever, it'll be fine. And just because it looks pretty, I'm going to do that. And we're going to pretend that that lines up with that little 10 right there. Woohoo! Okay, so we got that going. And now we're going to put in our moment. And so our moment goes from negative 24 to 0. So it's already at negative 24. And then it's going to go to 0. And again, I'm going to stop worrying about the fact that these are supposed to be open circles. And I'm just going to make them big, giant, fold-in circles. Okay. So this is positive 3x minus 30 is the function. And so this is going to have a slope of 3, which is a more, so the slope here is 3. So that's definitely more, what you call it, flat than this one over here, which has a slope of 8. Okay, so this is the mathy way to do this. And so when you have a complicated problem, this is always the way you're going to do this. Okay, this is always the way, this is always the way, this is always the way. Now let's take a look and see if maybe we can come up with some things to make this a little bit more straightforward. Now there's actually like a mathematical way to prove to you what I'm talking about, but I don't want to do it. So I'm just going to try and talk you through it. So I don't know if you can tell from looking at this, but there's definitely something going on here. Okay, so it turns out, and if you want to do this mathematically, you can, but it turns out that the shear in general is equal to the derivative of the moment diagram. So the shear diagram is the derivative of the moment. So if you look at this now, if you kind of look at what's going on here, we've got this slope. So remember that this equation was, what was it? It was 8x minus 40. So if I take the derivative of 8x minus 40, I get 8, right? So I get 8, which is why I wrote on there that the slope is 8. So the ddx of 8x minus 40 is 8, which is exactly where I am right here. So that's where that 8 comes from, okay? And then similarly, I could do the same thing here because this was 3x minus 30. So if I take the ddx of 3x minus 30, I get 3, which is exactly what this was up here, right? This value was 3, and this value was 8. So if I take the derivative of the moment, I can get the shear. And you're like, okay, well, I don't know if that really helps me because I had to find the shear to get the moment. Okay, true, true, true. I understand. But now let's look at what's going on between the shear diagram and the distributed load, okay? Because if you take a look, this is a little bit harder to see, but it's also true. So it turns out that we've got the shear is the derivative of the moment, and actually, also, the distributed load, so this is the distributed load is equal to the derivative of the shear, okay? So that's kind of weird, but I want you to think about it because, so what we've got here is what's the derivative of a constant? The derivative of a constant is zero, right? So there's no load there. The derivative of this constant is zero. There's no load there. Okay, so the only thing that you're seeing are these instantaneous changes. And the instantaneous changes are happening here, here, and here. Okay, and what you see here are you see these impulse functions here, here, and here. Okay, so those line up. So the area under the curve of that impulse function, of that discontinuity is the impulse function, which is the 8, the 8 pointing up, and then the 5 and the 3 pointing down. Okay, so you can actually see a relationship there as well. Another thing that you can probably see is that we can get our initial conditions for the moment diagram from our beam diagram as well, because we've got this initial 40, and then since we're like this, whenever we draw our little moment diagram, like when we're just trying to do like a little short, because of our convention, this is what our 40 would be, and then this is our unknown. So our unknown and our 40 are the same direction, so the unknown is negative. So that's why the unknown is negative. So whenever you have an initial moment, initial bending moment on your beam, that's going to coordinate to the opposite in sign of an initial bending moment on your moment diagram. So actually the whole goal of this is to, instead of having to do all the math, to be able to just look at the initial distributed load and then come up with the shear and moment diagrams just from looking at it. So like the way we would do it, and I'll work through it like one more time just to show you like, and then clearly, because that's pretty much how all your professors are gonna do it once they explain it to you once, everything else is just gonna be clearly. So like, see how this goes 8 up? This starts 8 up. So basically it goes 8 up, then nothing happens, now it goes 5 down. So right, the distance between here and here is 8 minus 3 is 5. This 5 and this 5 are related. And then we go boo 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 boo, and then we go down another 3, and that 3 and this 3 are related. So we go from 3 to 0, and that's 3, and then that 3 are related. Okay, so basically if you had this, the idea is you could just go straight to drawing the shear graph, okay? So let me erase all this extra stuff because it's a little scary looking. Okay, now whenever we go the other direction or whenever we go all the way to the moments, then we have even more to look at. Okay, so the same thing is that the shear is the derivative of moment, then moment must be the integral of shear, okay? So remember how we find integral is going to be area under the curve. So the area under this curve is going to be 8 times 2 is 16. So since we start off here, now it doesn't mean that we go straight to 16, but since we stopped at 40 or started at 40, then we're going to have an increase in the area under the curve of 16. So we have negative 40 plus 16 gets us to that negative 24. So we start at negative 40, add 16, and we get to that negative 24, which is right there. Then we're going to take the area under this curve, which is going to be 8 times 3, which is another 24. And so we start at 24, well, negative 24, and then we add a more area of 24. I can write this better. And then we add the area of 24, and then we end up at 0, which is where this 0 comes from. Okay, so that's kind of what we're going to do. So let's make sure that we've actually written this down. So since this isn't nearly as important as the idea that the moment is the integral of the shear, and generally speaking, the shear is the integral of the distributed load. Okay, now it can get a lot more complicated, but basically the concentrated loads are what's giving you discontinuities in the graph. So if we had a nice like triangular distribution, then we'd see like a nice up line, well, actually probably the other direction, but we'd see a linear thing. There wouldn't be these sharp points here. These sharp points are coming from the fact that these are discontinuities. They're just like, bam, out of nowhere, 5 pounds. Bam, out of nowhere, 3 pounds. So that's why our shear diagram is all kind of like unhappy with life, and that's because we have these just like point masses that we're having to deal with. So there is a lovely proof of all this stuff, but to me it's just a little bit easier to look at the picture and kind of see what's going on. Okay, so let me show you this whole problem one more time about how we can turn a problem that's basically taken us 15 minutes to talk about and into a problem that I can solve in about, you know, I don't know, what's going to be like a minute and a half or something. Okay, so I always want to make sure I get the units right, but basically as you're going to do is you're going to read this from left to right. Okay, now the first thing is you're reading left to right with the forces is you're going to see that 8 pound force. Now it's a little weird because the 8 pound force is pointing up, so you're like, okay, so shouldn't the reaction point down? The answer is, well, yeah, it does, except to remember that it's not going to be negative because it already points down. So if this is 8, then this is 8. It's not negative 8 because then that would mean it's pointing up. So the 8 up on the shear gives us a 8 up as an initial shear value right here. So whenever I see this, as I'm reading it from left to right, I'm gonna see that 8 pounds there, and I'm gonna immediately go, okay, awesome, I'm starting right here, okay? And then what's gonna happen is I'm gonna be like, and then nothing happens. Okay, so nothing happens, so look, nothing happens. Then the next thing that happens is I go down 5 pounds. So I'm gonna go down 5 pounds to here, and then again, nothing happens until I go down 3 pounds. There. Got it? Okay. So that's it. I'm already done with my shear diagram. And that's kind of weird because you didn't necessarily think that was going to happen, but it did. So actually just that quickly, I was able to come up with my shear diagram. Now for moment, it's really simple as well. Well, I don't say simple, but it's better than having to do all the math. So again, just to make sure I got the initial conditions right, remember that this is 40 going this way. And whenever I draw in my reaction forces, my generic reaction force is also positive. So that means my initial reaction is going to be negative 40. So I'm going to throw down here with the negative 40. Pachoo, like this. Okay, then I have area under the curve. It's above the x-axis, so it's a positive area. So it's 8 times 2, which is 16. So I'm going to do negative 40 plus 16. Gives me negative 24. Okay, and if you haven't already, be sure and review how to know what these lines look like. So this is a constant, which means that it's, so this here is a constant. So that means its derivative is a line, which is fine because lines look the same no matter, well, they look similar regardless. But it becomes more of an issue if this had been a line and then we were taking the integral of it to get a curve, like what that curve bends as. But right now, this is pretty straightforward. So this is the integral of a constant is a line. And what we should see is that this value here, which is 8, should be the slope of this line here. Okay. All right. And then we've got an additional area here, which is going to be 8 times 3. So that's 24. So negative 24 plus another 24 ends me up at 0. So that's 0. And since it was a constant, then that means the integral of a constant is a line. And it's going to have a slope. Since that value is 3, this is going to have a slope of 3. So that was a lot faster, maybe not a minute and a half faster, but definitely a lot faster than doing it all mathematically by hand. So the goal is that as you practice these, you get better and better at just like looking at the beam and then having an internal feeling for what that beam diagram should look like.